Excellent!
What is up, guys? How's it going? Welcome back to Paul's Hardware. Today's video is an actual video that's not our weekly live show on Tuesdays. I have actually been on hiatus, sort of involuntarily, for the past month or so. And if you want a little bit more details on that, go back to Awesome Hardware episode 136B. I discussed it a little bit at the beginning. To put it simply, though, we went through some pretty difficult family issues here, and now I am getting back into the swing of making videos because that's what I do. But I wanted to start just by saying a huge thank you to those of you who have reached out to me over the past few weeks or month. Since I just haven't been posting that much, quite a few people reached out and were like, just, hey, what's going on? Haven't seen you around. I miss you, that kind of thing. So I just want to say thank you to you guys. Even though I wasn't able to respond to everyone, I did try to respond to some people, and it makes me feel very loved, and it's very refreshing when people have reached out to me. So this is just a few who have said they miss me or whatever. So Smoke and Joe Camels and Michael O'Hara and Team 316 Tech, thank you guys so much for just reaching out and saying hi and everything. That said, though, Probing Paul is usually a monthly Q&A video that I do where I answer random questions that have been sent in by you guys, and I usually draw them from the previous video. And I actually haven't done my Q&A in a couple months either. The last one was in November, so I pulled some questions from there, and then I also have some questions that I got directly from Twitter, and I'm just going to get right into it here with the first question from Chris Johns, who asks, can your RAM be too fast for your motherboard? Some RAM goes all the way up to 3,000 megahertz, even beyond that. And a lot of motherboards cut off at 2400 or 2666. Will the 3,000 megahertz memory not work? Will it automatically run at the lowest compatible speed? So you kind of answered your question a little bit. Yes, it will run at the lowest compatible speed. Usually those are listed as the sort of the baseline speeds, and then anything beyond that is classified as an overclock. Overclock memory speeds can be sort of guaranteed to you by the memory manufacturer. So if you buy a kit of memory, like say this Corsair Vengeance kit, and it says DDR4 3000 or 2666 or whatever it's rated for, they've tested this memory, and in a system that supports that speed memory, this memory should work. But it's not just the memory's rating that matters, it also depends on the platform that you're installing it to. So AMD Ryzen CPUs, for example, can be a little bit finicky with higher speed memory, so it's very important to double check the memory that you buy with your manufacturer's QVL list. That will actually show you memory that's been tested by the manufacturer, the specific kit, that specific motherboard, and it will work. Beyond that, if you happen to get memory that's rated for a faster speed than you can actually run it, that's fine. You're just not going to be running it at the fastest speed that memory is actually qualified to run at. Next question here from Phantom Gaming. Hi, Paul. All current high-end GPUs are almost impossible to buy now, or the prices are inflated up to more than $1,000. And this is from 4 weeks ago. I don't know whether it's gotten better or worse since then. Probably a little bit worse. What is happening to the high-end GPUs like the GTX 1080 Ti? So if you watch my channel regularly, you're probably already familiar with cryptocurrency mining, which has become more popular on graphics cards over the past, I'd say, year or so. There was a boom in popularity in crypto mining with graphics cards back in 2013 and 2014 with Bitcoin, but then they started to develop ASICs, or application-specific integrated circuits, that were designed specifically to mine Bitcoin. Those are much more efficient than graphics cards, so it tapered off and prices went back to normal. What happened in the last month of 2017 and the first month of 2018 was you had Bitcoin prices, which went up and up and up and hit a max of around $20,000. You also have a bunch of what's called altcoins. You can't really mine Bitcoin with a graphics card anymore, at least not practically, but you can mine different cryptocurrencies that might work differently than Bitcoin, which makes them viable to mine with GPUs. Because of that, you had a bunch of people who were buying tons of graphics cards to either enhance their current mining configuration or get into crypto mining for the first time, and it's really difficult to say how much of that is people who are speculating because they see people making money in this market, how much of that is existing miners who already have big arrays and who are just constantly adding to them. But the long story short is that all of the graphics cards, retail, online, everywhere, got bought out, and then prices started to go up because when demand increases, price increases as well. And the crappy thing that we've seen recently is not just third-party sellers on marketplaces on Amazon and Newegg, but actually the retailers themselves, Newegg and Amazon, marking up the prices too. Now, there's arguments to be made there about whether that's actually legitimate or whether they're price gouging or that kind of thing. I don't really want to delve into that here, but basically, it's really hard to find a graphics card that costs a reasonable price right now. And all we can really do is kind of wait and hope that either the popularity of crypto mining with GPUs starts to decline, or GPU manufacturers start ramping up their production to meet those needs of people who are buying lots of GPUs. They're hesitant to do that because if they start ramping up production and then suddenly crypto dies, they'll be left with lots of GPUs that they can't sell for full price. So there's a lot of details and facets that go into the current dilemma that PC gamers are in of just like, I want to buy a GTX 1080 for $500 and they all cost $1,000 or more. It's a really crappy situation. It's also hurtful for people like me who try to recommend to people like you, hey, here's how to go and build your own computer and that kind of thing. The best solution right now that I've seen, the most viable, is to look for system integrators, so like boutique system builders and that kind of thing. Try to see if it's feasible to buy just a complete pre-built system for a reasonable price, because then you can kind of get everything integrated with the graphics card in there and often pay the same price for a whole system as you would buying just a graphics card directly at a grossly marked up price. Hopefully, since Bitcoin prices have dropped and the cryptocurrency market is still all sorts of unstable, we will see GPU prices start to come back down, but really there's no telling for sure, unfortunately. We just gotta wait and see what happens. Next question from Yaroslav Zinchenko says, hey Paul, is it necessary to calibrate monitors if I am, say, a web designer or a 3D modeler or a video editor? And follow up, do you calibrate your monitors? All right, answer to question one, necessary? No, but definitely helpful, and I would definitely recommend you do it, especially if you're a web designer, 3D modeler, or video editor. Follow up question, do I calibrate my monitors? No. At least I haven't for a couple years, and that's simply because I don't actually have a monitor calibration tool. The real ones that are required will plug in via USB, and you actually position them directly in front of your monitor, and then there's usually some software that goes and displays things, and it picks up the light and sees if it's actually seeing the lights it's supposed to be displayed, and it's very fancy like that. A monitor calibration tool like that will usually run between $100 and $200, or some really high-end monitors will sometimes come with them. What I actually have, at least on the monitor that I do most of my video editing on, is I have an Asus ProArt monitor that comes factory calibrated. Factory calibration is going to get you better color reproduction than, say, just a standard run-of-the-mill $100 1080 monitor or something like that, but most people who I've talked to say that even with factory calibration, there's still some tweaks and adjustments that they might make themselves if they, again, have that monitor calibration tool. So, if you're doing high-end work in web design, I would say it's probably going to be worth your while to get that, because you're going to be taking stuff that you create on your monitor and probably sending it to clients or something like that, and you want to make sure that what you're sending them is color accurate. And if you're working with something that's not the same thing as what they're displaying when they pull it up on their screens, then you might be showing people work that you're not 100% proud of. So definitely consider getting a higher-end monitor with good color depth, a 10-bit panel that can do 1.07 billion colors, for example. Definitely calibrate it, or see if you can rent or borrow a calibration tool in order to get your colors as accurate as possible. And then finally, I would say consider having a nice monitor and also a crappy monitor at the same time. And this is more geared towards, I guess, web design and that kind of thing, because on your nice monitor with good color depth, you might be able to pull up a project and, you know, do whatever you're doing in Photoshop or whatnot, and it might look really nice to you because you have good color depth and you can actually see details and the shadows and stuff like that. Also have connected a crappy 8-bit TN panel, something that's a bit more budget-oriented and lower-end, because that's what more people are more likely to be using at home. Then you can take your project on your nice monitor over here, bring it over to the crappier TN panel, and see what people are more likely to see as far as the user experience goes, and that can help you tweak certain things to make sure that even if you're developing stuff on a really nice monitor, even when you take it over to something that's not quite as nice, you're still getting a good experience. Now, my next question from Cool Moose is somewhat related. So he says he has a 6700K at 4.6 gigahertz and it's hitting 80 degrees Celsius, but it never used to go over 67. He's got a Corsair H110i. The pump does work. Is it possible that the TIM is going bad on the 6700K, or is it the AIO? Now that is a pretty significant jump, 67 all the way up to 80C. I don't know if you've been monitoring it over time and it's been slowly creeping up, or if that's something that just happened overnight. If it happened kind of overnight, I would probably point towards your pump. You might have a functional pump, but you might have a dying pump that's actually not operating at the full RPM and not pushing as much liquid through the loop as it was before, which could result in rising temperatures. Tim, going bad is definitely something that can happen, but if you use the stuff that just came pre-applied on the Corsair H110i, probably not the case. It usually takes a lot longer for Tim to actually dry out, and usually it's because it's like lower quality Tim that's not made to stand up over a long period of time. And from my understanding, Corsair does use good default Tim on their AIO units that they ship out. So those are my two culprits I would look at. I would definitely make sure you have your H110i hooked up with the USB so you can actually monitor the liquid temperature as well and make sure that's not getting too warm. That could be another indication that you're not getting good flow through your loop if you're temperatures are increasing, especially your liquid temperature. That should be staying below 60 degrees. And one more YouTube question here from Atomica J74. He says, what type of internet connection do you have? You do a lot of live streaming, which he can't do because his 100 megabits per second internet connection from Charter is horribly unreliable, and apparently no one would watch it. Well, don't assume that no one would watch it. It just takes a while to get started, and you have to be consistent and everything like that. And if you're having fun, then there's a decent chance that people will come along and watch. That aside, though, it does seem like you should have enough bandwidth to live stream, but I would say double check your internet connection and see if it's symmetrical. You might have 100 megabit down, but you might have a much narrower amount of bandwidth when it comes to upload speeds, and your upload speed is what matters when you are live streaming. So definitely something to keep an eye on there. Charter being unreliable might be something that's just local to you, but if they do have a package that could increase your upload speed or make it symmetrical with your download speed, that might help you out a little bit. But to answer your actual question, which is what I have, I actually am in an area here in Southern California that originally had Verizon Fios. So I actually have a fiber line that goes directly to my house. So I have fiber to the home, which is pretty nice and can scale up to a huge amount of bandwidth. Now they charge you more to provide you more bandwidth. So right now I have 100 megabit up and down. Actually, that just increased from 75 both ways to 100 both ways. And it's been a very reliable internet connection, so I can't say I have too much to complain about. It would have been nice if they didn't sell from Verizon to Frontier and stop deploying Fios in this area at all, because that kind of sucked when they did that. But I am fortunate enough to be in a spot where I have access to it. Okay, moving over to Twitter questions, and I tried to pick ones that I can answer fairly quickly, so this is my Twitter lightning round. First question from Jacob Hare. What was your earliest memory with a computer? That would be Commodore 64, and I specifically remember loading Jumpman Jr. up onto the Commodore 64 with a tape drive. It had it was like a white tape with a yellow sticker on it, and I put the tape in the drive, and then it would actually pull the data off of it and load up Jumpman Jr. That's my earliest memory. Next question from Mark Ruhr. Would you consider getting a 3D printer and messing around with it? Maybe even doing a short tutorial series with it. Mark, that's actually on my list of plans and things I'd like to do for this year, for 2018. I've mentioned once or twice on my channel that my wife actually works for Monoprice, and they make 3D printers, so I might be able to buy one using their employee discount through her, and then get it here and mess around with it and let you guys know what I think. Also, of course, I'm friends with Jerry, aka Barnacles Nerdgasm, and he does a lot of 3D printing stuff, so I could potentially hit him up and see if he can put me in touch with any of the 3D printing companies that he works with. But yeah, I find 3D printing fascinating and would probably be very useful for me, so definitely something I want to dabble in this year. Next question from Jorge Garcia. Who designed the Thumbscrew logo? So Thumbscrew logo was, I guess the concept was mine, and I just got some images of existing thumbscrews that I saw, and I actually worked with John, who handles our merch stores for me and Kyle and quite a few other YouTubers as well, and he worked with a designer, that he has in-house, to take it and sort of, we went through quite a few different iterations of it before we ended up with what you see on my shirt here, but yeah, the concept was mine, and the implementation, I guess, was working with John and one of his designers. And I'm really happy with how it turned out. And final question from Sting. What music do you listen to while working, if any? I really like listening to music while I do stuff because it helps me focus so much more. Unfortunately, when I'm like editing, I can't. Or when I'm recording stuff here, I can't like have music on at the same time. But what I've been listening to the most is Tycho. kind of through Kyle discovered them in the past year or two. And this is an upload from Cure Music that's Best of Tycho, which is a mix of a bunch of their different albums kind of put together. So I'll put a link to this in the video's description. It's like 3 hours, so can get you through a big chunk of time. Beyond that, I guess I would also say Ben Prunty and some of his work that he's done, especially the FTL Faster Than Light soundtrack, I also find to be nice and helps me get work done. And then I guess DJ Shadow. I like DJ Shadow. But guys, that's going to wrap it up for this Q&A video. Thank you guys so much for sticking with me through the past month or so. I know I've been on hiatus, but plan is to get back into it this week with my regular schedule of videos. So stay tuned for more coming up later this week. Definitely hit the thumbs up button if you enjoyed this video, and subscribe if you're not already for more tech videos coming at you real soon. Thanks again for watching, and we'll see you next time.